everyone. Welcome to Off the Clock. So good to be here. I'm Megan Telles in for Megan Henderson.
Welcome.
Thank you.
I'll tell the audience, buckle up. You got Rich DeMuro. We got you. We got a lot of high energy. When Rich is here, his full personality is on display.
Which so we love.
We love a little dark Rich.
They tell me to hold back on KTLA. But they're like, here, you can do whatever you want.
Exactly. And we love that about you.
Yeah.
Unleashed.
It's like somewhere between the radio and TV.
Plug your alma mater, but we have two Trojans here.
Fight on.
Tough loss last week. Yeah, that was not the best weekend to watch the game.
It was a great game, though.
But it
came down to the wire. And you were there.
I was there.
Went
to the big house. Stayed in Detroit. Drove into Ann Arbor. Great college town. It was fantastic. Went with my husband. The kids had their own little vacation with grandparents. It was all around. It's just a really good time. Next year, you got to come.
Okay.
Let's go.
Let's do it.
Where
are we going?
Nebraska.
Done.
You have to show
that was easy.
Pictures during show and tell at the end of the show.
Okay.
So you went to Michigan. I went to Las Vegas.
You were there,
too? So for the iHeart Festival. So it was so fun. My wife and I got a little time alone.
You got tickets to that?
Well, I work for iHeart, so it was, you know.
That's right.
His radio show.
Yeah, the radio show is through iHeart. So there was a lot of schmoozing with, like, all the iHeart folks and, like, meeting people and all the stuff.
So that concert where, every big artist does, like, two songs, that kind of thing, you got to be part of it.
It was great. I mean, it was so much fun. And it's always nice, like, as adults, like, as parents, you're always, like, going a million miles an hour. When you get that time, like, alone, and you're just like, oh, my gosh, we can do whatever we want right now. Like, go to dinner, hang out.
Yeah, not having to, like, schlep the kids. I mean, your kids are a little older. I'm in 4 and 1. So
yeah,
it's like, it's schlepping.
Yeah, you're still in it.
You've got all the equipment.
Diapers.
And then I can't hold him because he's so heavy.
Diapers for Troy, diapers for Caesar.
For Caesar.
I mean, you know, he can't handle his liquor. That's why.
Talk
about her husband. Not the baby. The baby can handle its liquor.
He can go.
Did you see that viral video of the baby drinking beer?
No.
One of the games?
Please tell me no.
I don't know if it was real or fake.
It was apple juice.
Frizzy, I hope so.
Fizzy apple juice. There's no way.
Anyway,
That's a call to social.
This
is the problem. This is the problem with scrolling through Twitter. You never know what's real anymore. And this is the problem. I'm sitting there, like, my whole life, I'm, like, figuring out, like, is this real? Did I just see something real or fake?
Here's my question. I'm being sincere when I ask it. Does your wife appreciate all the cool stuff you get to take her to?
I think so.
Yeah.
I think so.
Yeah, she goes, this is pretty cool. I'm married to Rich DeMuro.
Well, I don't think she says that. She's not like, oh, my gosh.
Yeah, you're so cool.
But no, it's just, you know, you also, it's a lot. I think there's so much coordination to do stuff that we get to do that it's, you know.
I know.
When you're there, it's like, let's just enjoy.
How many years have you been
married? 19.
Oh, gosh. Yeah. I almost put him on the spot.
Yeah, I know. I was like thinking.
Sorry about that.
College sweetheart.
Yeah, college sweetheart, yeah.
Yeah, wow. That's awesome, man.
Yeah.
That's good. But I know where you're coming from, because after a while, it's kind of like assumed, you know?
Yeah.
Oh, you're going to
where
that?
Where are you going now?
What time should
I be ready?
No.
That's, you guys look so wholesome.
Like, she's a great person.
Do you know they still do candlelight dinners?
I do know that. I stalk him
on Instagram. That's super romantic, isn't that?
Yeah, the kids, are they there?
They're sometimes there,
yeah. I've seen them in a couple
The kids like the candles. We've taught them how to light the candles.
It's not an electronic candle. You actually light it?
First of all, electronic candles are great for, like, random ambiance, but real candles are good for the... You don't go, hey, honey, let's be romantic and go click.
Flip the switch. The
He's
fireplace
like the
comes on.
God.
The candle.
Well, the fireplace is okay.
I know.
Fireplace switch is okay, but the candle, you know...
Hey, baby, look at my switch.
Yeah.
All right.
Here's what is on tap for today. What's in a name? A new study reveals how many parents experience baby name regret.
And we've got Casey Montoya in to talk about the 4th annual golf tournament for her charity, Fixin' Fidos. We'll tell you how you can be part of the big day and the big giveaway.
Yes, the big giveaway is a great one. Mm-hmm. It really is. All right. Plus, the way you sign your emails could change your mental health. We will explain.
All right, so every generation has its version of parenting struggles, but BuzzFeed talked to teachers about what boomers did right that millennial parents do not do.
That's supposedly. You, buddy.
How do they
That's
know?
You.
Okay, here are some of the interesting ones. Millennial parents don't let their kids be bored.
That's so
important. That's actually true.
Do you know what my dad literally said to me one time during summer break of a high school year? I don't remember what year it was. And I was like, I can't remember what I was saying. I was frustrated about it. She goes, you know what your problem is? You need to learn how to be bored.
Your dad was ahead of his time.
Yeah.
Because that was like a couple years ago.
So this is in the 80s.
Yeah.
Right?
So they're saying that millennials, we don't allow that. We're constantly
You're constantly scheduling.
Go, go, go.
Yeah.
And can I tell you, I don't think my daughters know how to be bored. Like they're like we're not doing anything. You want to go to lunch? And I'm like,
just like chill.
Yeah.
No, just go. I tell my kids, I go, go outside and find a worm. Literally, yeah. I go, go open, like uncover a rock and like yeah. look what's under there.
Yeah.
Because they don't know how to do that. Like when we were kids, we just like hung around. And you'd be like, what do you want to do?
We'd yeah. ride bikes around the neighborhood.
Oh, yeah. Like, and you'd find crazy stuff. Late. That's also when you got the yeah. call from the neighbor saying, yes. your son just broke a lamp, yeah. you know, a street lamp, throwing rocks at it.
Totally.
Okay, another teacher said, the idea happiness is a constant right. Millennials feel that teaching their child they should always be happy and have all the good things.
Mm.
Several teachers commented on the number of kids who talk back to teachers or tell them no.
Yikes.
One noted millennial parents forget that teens lie. When they talk to parents, they often get, my child would never do that, or teaching kids independence, or telling kids no, and no holding kids accountable seem to be a thing of the past.
Mm.
That is a great point. So I just read the book, The Anxious Generation.
Oh,
highly recommend that book for any parent out there or any okay. educator. But one of the points is that we used to have a collective parenting society.
Right.
Where, like you said, when you were out in your neighborhood, the neighbors knew who you were, they
yep.
knew your parents, they yep. kind of knew who to call if there's a problem. Nowadays, nobody does that.
Right.
And also, you would never, like if your child came in here and was doing something a little off, I yeah. would never reprimand them because we don't do that
right.
anymore.
Right. You would just go home and talk about her child.
Yeah, oh, 100%. I'm Jeez, doing that anyway.
It's, yeah.
That's so true.
But that's a
like
little
a
bit of a...
village mentality, yeah. like we've sort of lost yeah. that.
I think that, and again, sports aren't the end-all be-all, but one of the things I really do love about team sports growing up is you're going to learn some hard lessons.
Yeah.
You're going to learn there's always something better, someone better than you. There's always someone more talented than you. You're going to hear the word no. Mm-hmm. No, you can't go into the game because you're not good enough mm-hmm. right now or whatever. So I just think, and you learn to play for other people, mm-hmm. a larger team thing. That's why I think, like if I could say what was the common thread besides, you know, the way my wife and I were both raised, I would say they all were in team sports from the youngest of ages, and they changed. It wasn't always the same sport. They,
yeah.
they almost all of them changed sports as they got older and found something that was really their passion, not just something I exposed them to.
Yeah.
So I really agree with what's being said there, and I'm not saying that the new way, there's so many, the way that you get to-
I mean, we're responding to how our generation
yeah.
was raised sort of things.
Right.
There's certain things that you guys do that are way better. Because I got the belt.
Okay,
when
yeah,
I messed up growing up, I
yeah.
got the belt.
We don't touch yeah. the best. What about gentle
yeah.
parenting? Although
yeah.
sometimes, you know, you got to kick it in.
Corporal punishment was very real yeah. when I was growing up.
But I think yeah. I also think that on the flip side, today's parents are much more open with their children.
Totally.
Like, my kids will ask me questions that I would never ask my parents.
Right.
And I'm like, okay,
and, I, yeah.
and you answer them, and yeah. you are back and forth.
Which helps.
Which I think is good.
And yeah. allowing the kids, I feel like, at least right now, raising two littles, is there's this big emphasis everywhere on mental health.
Oh, yeah.
So making sure at a young age that the kids are, it's okay to have these big feelings right now, but you cannot throw things.
Yeah.
You can
yeah.
be mad. It's, in fact, be mad.
Yeah.
What is that lesson in there? And, like, so we have those conversations in breathing, deep breathing. Lola
yeah.
sometimes, you know, that's when she was smaller. It's like, okay, take deep breaths, because sometimes that's all it is. It's just breath work. We're just a little worked up, and so we've really worked
yeah.
on that.
We never had that as
no,
kids.
No, we didn't have that
no.
as kids. Sweetie,
breath work.
Take a deep
Dad's
breath.
Dad's coming. When Dad comes home from work,
oh
he's giving
God.
You breath work.
Well, I'm gonna call
he's
going to
teach you how to breathe. Okay.
That, you know what's funny, though? The when Dad comes home from work thing was
oh.
very real in
oh,
my
yeah,
house.
Oh, yeah. That was real in my house,
very,
too.
And we knew we were getting the belt, and it was no fun.
Like, no.
Yeah, that was like, oh.
It would all be saved up. Mom would be keeping a list of
yeah.
all
oh.
the things you did wrong. And then Dad, coming home from work, exhausted.
So
yeah.
The last thing he wants to do
was,
is hear all these
yeah.
problems with the kids.
Oh, that was
hair.
Such a way of life in my house. All right. She, you know, she, my mom raised three boys, then had
That's
my sister way late in life. All right, a new survey may help put some worried moms' minds at ease. If you regret the name you gave your kid, you're not alone. This is surprising to me.
Yeah.
I think most kids look like their name.
Totally.
You know what I mean?
Eventually,
grow into
yeah.
it, yeah.
A Baby Center survey found almost 1 in 10 mothers say they chose the wrong name for their child. About 1 in 5 say they prefer their child's nickname, whether it's a shortened version of their real name or a different name altogether. 10% of moms say the name they chose just doesn't match their kid's personality. And 15% say they've seen other parents criticize or make fun of the name they chose. Well, that's not cool that they chose. Unless you, you know, go with something like particularly odd.
Gosh, that's not a very nice parent.
No, not at all.
Those millennial parents.
Yeah, that's a millennial parent for you.
Yeah.
I think the kids grow into their names. Like, it's agreed. A lot of pressure at the beginning when you're trying to name your kid. Yeah. But at the end, it's like, it fits them.
And how often does it really stay the birth name? It's usually an iteration of it. You yeah. know, like, Lola Ray, yeah, it gets shortened down to Lola a lot of times. Or Lolis, or my Troy boy.
Yeah.
T-Dog, or, you know.
T-Dog. T-Dog. T-Dog.
Knuckles T-Dog, you know.
Oh, that's hilarious. Like,
yeah. Yeah, I don't have regret. Do you have regret?
Not at all. Okay, so I got the name Sydney and Shelby, our older ones. And then I was strongly pushing for Sierra and Savannah.
Okay, S's.
For the last two. Mm-hmm. And my wife Katrina was like, first of all, those, if you're named Sierra or Savannah, I apologize.
My wife goes,
those sound like prostitutes. I'm like, what are you talking about? Those are beautiful names. She goes, they're a little prostitute-y. And I go, okay. So then came Kendall and Kelsey. So yeah.
So Kendall and Kelsey, like Katrina, but then you got the two S's for Schauble.
I just like the alliteration. Yeah. Okay. I always like those names. And so, you know, they love their names. You know, they're cool with everything. So it worked out great. No regrets.
Well, you there look you like a Rich, and you certainly look like a Chris.
Well, you know what my original birth
That's
name
right.
was? My original birth, well, you know, I'm adopted. My original birth name, and I didn't find this out till I was in my 40s when I did my whole find my parents thing, was Mark Robinson. So for 3 days, I was Mark Robinson.
How do you feel about that?
You're watching the KTLA 5 Morning News, and I'm Mark and I'm Mark Robinson. It would have worked.
It almost took down the whole set.
Mark Robinson is a very more traditional. Chris, you know, Schauble. My father, my adopted father was German. So, you know, long.
I think it fits. Both fit. Yeah. I think both could fit.
Yeah, Mark Robinson would have been my birth name.
It's interesting that you still use that online as your secret identity.
Yeah, exactly.
Next time you see a Mark Rowe.
Actually, no. We'll leave that alone. The North Carolina candidate, which we don't talk politics on this show,
okay.
He's not having the best go of it right now.
Okay.
Yeah, so you put my name in and you get his situation and it'd be
okay,
something.
I don't know.
Yeah.
If your child's a picky eater, a new study finds genetics may play a role in their eating habits. Researchers in the UK say finicky eating can last from toddlerhood to early adolescence, peaking at around age 7. Scientists studied 2,400 sets of twins through 13. They discovered fraternal twins were much less similar in their picky eating than identical twins, pointing to a large genetic influence in the behavior. Researchers also found fussy eating among identical twins started to vary as the children got older. That is a phase that you want to get out of.
Yeah.
Picky eating and stuff that you like especially. Like, just try it.
Here's my thing. You're going to starve in my house if you're a picky eater. You can go make your own food, fine. But if you're a picky eater, this is what we're having.
Figure it out.
Figure it out. And when they're young, there were no options. When I hear these parents like, oh, my kid only eats. Because you taught them that. You allowed
gave them. Freedom.
They may not like it all the time. I'm not saying kids don't have likes and dislikes. But for you to allow, like literally, I think there's someone I know whose kids are like in their early teens and they only eat like nuggets and something else.
Oh, come
I'm like,
on.
No, I'm not kidding.
I'm afraid of that because that's all Lola wants right now.
That's a different, like,
food.
That happens. And it's all, it's all face. Like, it's like, she likes, of course, it's, who doesn't like nuggets?
But
like, she's not going to like certain things that adults like until later on. You keep trying. That's the thing. Always keep trying. Like, my kid liked pizza without sauce for so many years. Cheese bread.
Yeah.
And so every time we'd have pizza, I'd be like, now try it again. Didn't like sauce on pasta. Try it again. And now he likes both.
Great.
Yeah.
Okay.
One of the things that is the great breakthrough for kids is when they do get into like middle school, there's certain things they think that, like, my daughter was deathly afraid of roller coasters, right? One of my older ones. Like, from the time she was little. But as soon as she got hanging around friends and everyone's having fun at the amusement park, guess who likes roller coasters? Really? So my point is, when they get older, the whole peer thing kicks in and things that they, you know, I don't like scary movies. All of a sudden, they're hanging out at movie theaters, going to scary movies, and they're also going to all at once. They're friends, once that peer stuff kicks in, stuff that they said
good
they,
and bad, because in college it's the beer and, you know, all the other stuff. So you got to be careful. It works
very true. Very well said. Time now for today's question of the day. What food do you think tastes better as leftovers the next day? I've got two right off the top of my head. Chinese food tastes great the next day. And
cold. Don't
and, thank
it.
You.
Wait,
that's,
what?
Yes.
Cold noodle.
No.
Cold
yes.
Chinese
no
food right here.
Not the chicken.
Yes. And,
well, the chicken's a little tough.
No, orange chicken.
You're right.
Orange chicken cold.
Orange chicken does need to be heated up because it's tough. It's tough.
Because it like congeals a lot.
Yeah, well,
right? Yeah. Yeah, it's good.
So it doesn't, but the like the beef and broccoli, definitely
cold?
Better than
a cold mushroom.
Oh, come on. I've never had
mushroom
food.
Chicken.
Yes, the beef,
cold.
Yes.
It's so funny. I'm not lying. Okay. Panda. From last night, sitting in the fridge right now, guess what I'm having when I get home?
As soon as you get home.
Yeah, now my mouth's watering for it.
Wait, how about the white rice, though?
I always go brown rice or the chow mein.
Okay, because the white rice cold gets in little clumps.
Yeah.
Okay, like biting rice and it falls.
That's no, but the chow mein cold still works.
Chow mein
cold. Maybe not the best. Orange chicken definitely needs to be heated up. But the rest of it.
What's the benefit of not heating it up?
Because you get to eat it right away, and it tastes good still.
Yeah, microwave is like 30 seconds.
Rich, I can't wait 30 seconds. No. But in all seriousness,
this is so surprising.
It tastes good.
And pizza.
Okay, yeah, that was my other
pizza.
One.
Okay, so cold with pizza, I understand cold pizza, and I understand like sometimes you're just so hungry, like I'll just eat it out of the fridge. Yeah. But like Chinese food, I would have never thought in a million years to not
heat
it up.
I actually prefer it this week.
Wow. Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm.
Especially beef and broccoli. That's a solid.
Why is Panda over there serving things hot?
Why waste your time?
What the heck? Yeah. Just take that frozen orange chicken.
You know what's funny? You know what's funny? You actually may be onto something. A restaurant that only served like cold stuff that you would normally
have. Here I am going to Mongolian barbecue, heating it
up.
I could eat that stuff
cold.
Just frozen cold.
Cold baby.
And
yeah.
It could be served to you in seconds.
Okay.
Yeah.
See? You're not waiting 15
it'll be a
minutes.
It'll be a TikTok trend now.
That's so funny.
Gosh.
I'm eating frozen food, frozen.
It's like cold and ready. Yeah.
That's funny.
Little Caesars could be on.
Yeah, it's called Jamba Juice. Everything served cold.
All right, so do you have others besides pizza and Chinese?
You brought up Chinese food that I agree with. Mine's pizza.
All right, and then what about you?
I honestly, like, I think soups and, like, pastas, like, anything that has a little bit.
Wait.
I'm not eating it cold.
No, he's not doing cold.
I'm not eating it
cold.
Cold
was us.
That was you guys.
He's saying that, like, because we went, like, the next day assuming that you had it in the fridge. Because there's certain things, do you know this? There's certain things that actually you don't refrigerate. You can't keep it very long. But, like, fried chicken. Like we don't we air fry it to reheat it. So
yeah,
we
but cold fried chicken is delicious.
Yeah, see? Again.
Okay, I
oh
give
my
up.
Gosh, you're right.
Rich is like, I give up.
Go to like Stater Brothers, just
yeah,
get
Rich
back.
Is like, I'm out of here. See, Rich is like, who are you Neanderthals?
What the heck?
Where are you from?
Okay, do you eat anything cold?
Jersey boy.
I said I'll have a slice of pizza cold once in a while. What? But like no, I like my food
heated.
Well, you know, everyone
I mean now I'm trying to think okay, ice cream, I do warm that up.
Actually, I do. You want to know why? Sometimes it's so
it?
No. Sometimes it's so hard coming out of the freezer that you literally can't scoop
okay.
it.
Okay, oh, what I've gotten from
you,
you dip it in hot water.
Okay. What I've gotten from you is that you cannot wait for your food. You,
Chris,
ice cream.
No, ice cream, I actually put it in the. In
I know,
the,
I'm saying leave it out on the counter for 10 seconds. It'll get a little
10
bit.
10 seconds?
That was not 10 seconds.
Okay, a couple minutes.
How do you feel about Uncrustables? Because you have to freeze them.
I
and
can't
then you have
wait
to
for those.
Take
yeah.
out the Uncrustable the yeah. night, well, like a couple, I don't know, like an hour before so you can defrost.
That's a tricky one.
Now you're like, I might eat those cold.
No, I would not.
You warm up an Uncrustable?
No, but yes, I know that you have to leave it out for like a, that's a whole nother thing. Like that's a whole nother topic. Like the whole like taking something out of the freezer the night before to like cook it.
Yeah.
Because of course that night when it comes around, you don't want to eat that.
Correct.
Like I took out these three chicken breasts and like, oh, now I really want to go here. Yeah.
Yeah.
But that's a whole nother conversation. I will say,
chat.
I think stuff that kind of like solidifies overnight, like the spices kind of mix in, I think always tastes better. But I think most food tastes better the next day.
I'll throw one more in. You guys familiar with the Boiling Crab? They have a few of those locations. I know they have one in Westwood. I think they have one in Gardena or something like that. And they
I
have one in Burbank.
Calabasas, I think, or on the
so
way.
There's a number. And then there's a number of restaurants that serve basically the same style of seasoned, you know, shrimp in a bag. And you put corn or potatoes. Eggs.
Very southern.
You do that on you put it on the table. I love the next day when the spices have really soaked in. Now you're talking.
It's been a while. Like I lived in Louisiana, we had crawfish boils.
Yeah.
So I'll never forget my first time there. I'm like, when I was growing up, we used crawfish as bait.
Yeah.
And then I get to Louisiana, like we eat these. I'm like, wait, what? You must have a different creature. And like, no, it's this thing. Yeah. It's like moving all around.
Yeah, and it's just tiny. You just snap it and
I can say I've never had. I've done the.
You suck like the head out or something.
You suck the head.
Right?
That's what they say. You suck the head. Yeah, it's a mini shrimp without nearly the payoff. Yeah, it's a lot. I'm just gonna be honest. It's a lot of work.
It's a lot, and it's also like it looks just it looks like a little creature.
Yeah, it looks like a little lobster.
Yeah.
Is what it looks like. What about you, Kristen?
I'm with you. Cold pizza. My love cold pizza. And then almost any kind of pasta is really good the next day. But honestly, I'm like Rich. I kind of like almost anything is a good leftover.
What about hot, cold situation?
I am more of a heated person. It depends on what it is.
Yeah.
It just depends.
Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. She keeps it hot.
Yeah.
She likes it like it's hot.
So you're saying you heat up Campbell's soup in a can before you eat it?
I would do that. Okay. Although when I was a kid, I used to eat like the Chef Boyardee. I cold? Used to just eat that cold right
By
out of the
way,
can.
Wow.
I'm with her on that, and I'll take it a step farther, that chunky soup stuff. Sometimes we keep it room temp in our thing.
Do not say you've had this.
I've had it room temp out of the
can
like it's nothing. I'm a Neanderthal. What can I say? I don't do it. It's not how I eat regularly, I am admitting on camera that there has been a time or two in my entire life where I'm like, I'm starving. That clam chowder and that chunky can.
Oh
looks
my God!
Great.
I cannot wait 2 minutes.
Yeah. I am like in shock right now.
No, yes, yes. I am a Neanderthal.
Someone this is a new can. One.
Yeah,
it's so good.
I'm with you, Kristen.
I love it.
And by the way, there's people at home
who are agreeing with you.
Yeah,
totally identify.
They're like, I'm seen finally.
or they're really grossed out. Either way, we'll get to the viewers here. We'll start on Instagram. Dina said, "Jack in the Box tacos, cold." Rich,
nice.
Cold.
Okay, well.
Two Foxes said meatloaf. Jay Will said chili.
Oh, that's a good one.
That's another good one where the seasoning.
Mm-hmm.
Really
it's the seasoning. The Malicious said sauce, gravy, soups, and chili. Decker Nina said enchiladas, spaghetti, and potato salad.
Yeah.
Archie said any type of Italian sauce. My 11-year-old loves pad thai. Mm. And then Cynthia said goulash, nice and greasy. Mm. On X, Renata said chicken salad, all the ingredients meld together. Pink Princess said spaghetti. Roland Joint said absolutely nothing.
There's people that hate leftovers.
Yeah.
Megan
Henderson's one of them. That's why I didn't do the question.
Hate, if you don't, my whole thing is, like, maybe it's just how I was, like, how. You make this food, you made more than you actually needed, not a problem. It's probably a good thing to have and not need. So what do you do with it?
To be fair, the portions at Erewhon where Megan's getting her food are very small. There's not a lot left over. So
I will say on Fridays in my house, typically, it's either we're going out to dinner or it's
leftovers.
Just, leftovers.
Good.
Oh, we call them scrounge nights. I love that. It's like a free dinner.
Yeah.
You know,
if
you like find stuff in your cabinets to make or whatever, I love those nights.
Excuse me.
Sometimes leftovers, like looking, I look forward to them at night. Well, I'll go to bed at night and like, I can't wait to eat that in the morning.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Especially if it's good. Like, Panda Express, always. I'm like, the kids are like, can I have some more? I'm like, doesn't look like there's much more in here for you, kids.
Okay. On Facebook, Karen said pizza. Richard also said chili, more chili. Danielle said lasagna. A lot of lasagnas. Mm. Jeffrey said anything instant from a box other than a half eaten oversized burrito.
Huh.
Nick said enchilada casserole. Ugh, I love a casserole.
That looks good too.
Yep. Chris said pizza with ranch dressing.
Oh wow.
Gilda, stuffing and turkey, the gravy from Thanksgiving. Mm. Big dinners like that, always great leftovers.
Lots of leftovers.
David, also Thanksgiving leftovers.
By the way, at our house, we insist that our guests take a plate because we know we can't eat all the leftovers. So whenever people come over, whatever the occasion, but especially a holiday where we know we're going to have a lot of extra food, like so much extra food that it can't be eaten in a reasonable time, we insist. And most people are happy to take it. They want more turkey and more everything for later, you know.
Thanksgiving dinner style food is really good the next day as
Yes.
Put it all in
mac
a sandwich,
and cheese the next day.
In Vegas, and I was in Vegas, lived there for a couple years, my first market, we'd get Capriotti's. Is there a Capriotti's here? Are you familiar with that?
The I know it's
shop?
Got the pulled
and
sandwich.
They have a Thanksgiving
turkey,
they have a Thanksgiving like order on the menu where it's a sandwich and there's a cranberry and turkey and stuffing and all the fixings, but it's year-round.
They used to have one on Wilshire Boulevard.
Oh, okay. Here in
right in Beverly Hills. And I used to get that sandwich.
Oh.
Yeah.
Nice.
Leftover guy.
All right. We've got just a couple more I'll do. Sven said the spaghetti I made last night will be better today.
Yep.
Delicious. Mm-hmm. Debbie said pot roast. Mm. And so did Laura. And I actually, pot roast was one of my ideas too.
That looks really good.
I love a good pot roast. And then we'll end here with Beverly. Her cheesecake actually tastes better 2 days later if it stays around that long.
Right.
Love a good cheesecake.
Good for you, Bev.
We dig
Looks good.
You know what else? We'll be right back.
Well, today is National Quesadilla Day. There are a few theories about how and where quesadillas were invented. Some say they were brought to the West from Spain, but most people believe they originated in Chile's. Oh, sorry, in the southern regions of Mexico, where Aztecs made corn tortillas. My kid loves quesadillas.
Especially Tanner. When you dress them up. You can do it. You can put chicken in them. You can put a little tomato in them. You can really, you know, go to town with it.
Yes. Yeah, that is something we learned during the pandemic.
But you, in my opinion, you cannot have enough cheese.
So when I came to California.
Yeah, dripping out of it.
No.
Yeah, believe it.
And then when it hardens a bit, and it's like.
Oh, I love a congealed
Thank
cheese.
Thank you, Kristen. Not
you guys in your cold food.
We're vibing
put
on
the cheese.
Cheese.
Don't heat it up. So I never heard of a quesadilla in my entire life until I came to L.A. And I will never forget being in my dorm room at USC, and they said, we're going to make a quesadilla. I said, what is that? And they took a tortilla and a piece of American cheese.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
And put it in there.
Not the preferred cheese.
No, this was like college dorm, you know, poor, whatever. And they just put it in the microwave, and I was like, oh, that's really good.
Yeah.
It's like it's a cheese sandwich.
Yeah, basically. It's like a grilled cheese. I mean, but it's
just stuck on
so good.
I've never heard of a quesadilla until you came here. That's hilarious.
There was Mexican food in New Jersey was like not really a thing growing up.
I don't realize
and now,
that.
Of course, it is. But like it was not. Like growing up, there was
wasn't
like
even
one
a Taco
place.
Bell?
There was Taco Bell.
But
maybe I didn't go.
As you well know, not considered the height of Mexican food.
I was going to say, Friday night family dinner. They're like, kids were going out to Taco Bell and getting a gordita. What was that thing?
Gordita. Cheesy gordita crunch?
Yeah.
Or how about a Mexican pizza? Or was that Del Taco?
No, they had that.
That was Taco.
No, that was the thing. And then Del Taco serves the cheeseburger. So when I came, it was like, they have this great
Mexican
cheeseburger
food,
at Del Taco.
It's the same stuff, just put in different ways.
Yes.
A quesadilla is a tortilla and cheese. You maybe have some tomatoes in there. A taco is a hard tortilla and cheese and meat. And then you have an enchilada, which is a wrapped tortilla with the meat and the cheese. Yeah.
I ended up working at a Mexican restaurant in New Jersey, one that they opened, and as a waiter. And I learned, I got to taste everything, like the flautas. Yeah. Like I got that. Like,
my second job was at a Mexican restaurant. I was a busboy. And then
my second job too.
Yeah, and it was.
Did you get the meal every shift?
I got a meal every shift.
That's the best.
That's the best part.
Busing is so important. You really.
Busing is when you're 16, it's good money.
Yep.
We're talking good money.
On a good night.
You're the lowest level of the restaurant. I mean, dishwashers are here, and busboys
bus
are like here, right?
You're delivering two dishwashers.
But again, for a 16-year-old, it was a great job.
Yeah.
Good for you. That's why you're such a good man, Schauble.
I try.
Foundation is strong. All right. How serious are you about celebrating your wedding anniversary? A woman shared this story on Reddit. She says she is a 37-year-old woman married to a 38-year-old man. She wrote that for their 10th anniversary, she took the day off of work, hoping to, you know, spend the day with her hubby. But that didn't happen, even though he also had the day off. Mm. The woman says on her anniversary, she woke up to a gift, but it was on the end of the table. Then she dropped the kids off at school. Now, when she came home, she made her husband breakfast and brought it to him in bed. Okay. But he was still asleep. So she ended up eating the breakfast. Well, when he woke up, he said, happy anniversary. Then went to make his own breakfast. She asked him if he had any plans. He said, to relax. She added that she wanted to go out and do something together, but he said, no.
Ah.
So she left and treated herself to a spa day.
Good for her.
When she came home, he asked why she left all day, and she told him, well, she didn't want to just do nothing. The question she posed is, was she wrong to leave all day?
All day part, I need more details in that. But here's the thing. Yeah. You know the problem is a lack of communication. Mm-hmm. You should
1,000%
have your anniversary figured out well before
Thank
the
you.
Day you're waking
Thank
up.
You.
That
Come
part
on.
Seemed a little disconnected
There's a lot
to
of
me.
Issues in this
relationship. She was hoping that he would do something, but if that's not his personality, and for 10 years if he has shown to not be that, then why would you expect it on one day?
Yeah.
And also you've had 10 anniversaries to kind of figure out the vibe on anniversary day. Like, are you more of like anniversary, we keep it in, we keep it with the kids, or you go on the trip?
No, we go on the trip.
You go on the trip.
Always. Yeah. Always.
That's sweet.
And,
that's special,
one of the great things about where we live is you can do a staycation.
Yes, that's what we do.
My wife and I like going to the marina just for a night or somewhere like that, you know. And
that is a good thing about this area. There's so many places
you can
to go.
San Diego, Santa
Barbara. We went to San Ynez last anniversary. It was great.
And so many places you've never been.
It was so perfect.
Exactly. Ojai. So many great places you can just get away to for a night. you know, just to celebrate. So yeah, that I fault, not even the day, before they even got to the day, that there was no communication, like, 100%. Hey, I think we might be both be off. What would you like to do? Oh, I want to sleep in. Okay, what do you want to do after you sleep in? You know, that kind of stuff.
Yes.
You know?
They didn't mention the age of the kids, and that could be a factor. When your kids are really little, like, you're in the thick of it, and, like, maybe you don't have the time, and it, like, comes up. But didn't they say it was the 10-year?
Yeah.
That's a big one. That's
a huge one.
You're thinking about that. Like, no, if you've made it 10 years,
So it's what are you going to renew your vows? What are you going to do?
You've brought that up, and we've thought about it, because we had a very large...
Even if you do something small, it's very meaningful.
There's a part of me that wants to do that, but then
I do it in your backyard.
I feel schlep. I feel a lot of focus on not just us two. You know what I mean? Like, maybe that plus something for just us two.
Sure.
I really want the big trip. I want the Euro trip.
I was going to say, Hawaii's also really nice.
Yeah, Hawaii's nice. Next trip to Hawaii that I want to take the kids. It's a little slow for me. It's a little slow.
Are you going to go to the Disney property? Because I hear it's fantastic
for
Alani?
Young
people.
Yeah. Yes, in a couple years with the kids.
That would be phenomenal.
Absolutely. But
that's,
not for our
That's Maui? Is that Maui?
No, that's Honolulu.
Okay, so it's Oahu.
It's like outside. It's like a little bit outside that area. But I think it's called the Big Island, or no?
No, the Big Island is Kona.
Okay.
So Hawaii, yeah. So, yeah.
Yeah. Another thing, being from New Jersey, you don't know the islands of
Hawaii.
Well,
trust me, I had to figure it out. The only reason I know this is because I did the Iron Man on Kona.
Okay.
So that's why I know that's the Big Island. Ooh. So, anyway. Still to come, Casey Montoya stopping by to chat about the 4th annual Fixin' Fido's golf tournament and how you can take part. Off the clock, coming right back.
Hello, everyone. An upcoming golf tournament raising money to support rescue animals.
Not just any upcoming golf tournament. Casey Montoya here to tell us more about the 4th annual Fixin' Fido's golf tournament. Casey, we love having you here.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming in, sharing your time with us. Before we talk about the tournament, some of our viewers might not know what Fixin' Fido's actually does. Please tell us about your charity.
So I started it in 2017 because you see our shelters, they are full. We watch animals die for absolutely no reason. And the only solution, it turns out, is spay and neuter. But it's not a sexy topic. So I decided, come up with a cute, sexy logo and try and educate the public. And this is the way that we're doing it. We're raising money. We pay for spay and neuter for low-income families here in SoCal. And also, another way that we keep pets out of shelters, we help with smaller vet bills, because imagine you're low-income and you have a $300 vet bill. Well, you think the best thing for your animal is to take them to the shelter because you can't provide the care. So if we can step in, then those beloved pets can stay in their homes and not end up overcrowding our shelters even more. So this is a hallway of South Los Angeles shelter. There are so many animals right now in those shelters. They're doubled and tripled up in cages. They're fighting. They're not getting walks. And we can stop this, but it's with spay and neuter. And so that's why we do this big event every year. It's the biggest fundraiser we have. And the goals for this coming year, we don't want to just continue to help people one-on-one. We want to do these big events. Like earlier this year, we did an event where we fixed 90 cats in 2 days. Like, imagine the impact that is making on our pet population in SoCal. So we're really excited to have this going again.
Yay. You are the new Bob Barker.
I mean, help control the pet population.
I mean, come on. He said that at the end of every show. And as a kid, you're like, what the heck does that mean? Yeah. As an adult, you realize how important that is.
Yeah. Yes.
And I do remember it. Tell us about the tournament.
So a lot of KTLA celebrities will be there. Glenn Walker, Lou Parker. Henry is actually golfing this year.
Oh,
that's a big guess.
By the way, Henry's a good golfer.
He is. And Kirk Hawkins is golfing this year, you guys.
Now, I don't know if he is.
He is a good golfer.
Is he really?
Yeah, he played in college, he said. So
I could see that.
He will be there. And then Megan, you and Lauren are going to come after the show. A lot of other KTLA talent will join. So here's the deal. If you don't golf, well, if you do golf, we still have room. You can sign up. There's a few spots left, a couple foursomes. You can come to the awards ceremony, which is like the silent auction. It's fun. It's a dinner. We've got like live music, comedians this year. So you show up around 2:30 in the afternoon, maybe a little earlier if you want to browse the auction items. And you get to meet all the KTLA staff. The golfers are coming in. There's all this energy. And this is how we raise the big money. And we are at Monarch Beach Golf Links in Dana Point. So the ocean view, I mean, hello.
Yeah, that's phenomenal.
So you can't, it couldn't be in a better place. And this year, so South County Lexus Mission Viejo, one of our big sponsors, they gave me this opportunity to raise more money. So every golfer's dream is to go to Pebble Beach. So what if you could play? So this is a raffle we get to do.
My gosh.
If you could play Pebble Beach, Spyglass, Spanish Bay, and stay up there in a hotel, like, wouldn't you buy a $100 raffle ticket?
By the way, I've played Pebble.
Did you do that?
I have that. Let me just tell you, that if you asked I would say 9 out of 10 golfers, if they could golf anywhere in the world, some might say St. Andrews, maybe some, but I think 9 out of 10 would say Pebble Beach.
Yeah, wow. So we have the chance for you to do that, golfing at all three, 54 holes at these amazing courses. And again, we'll get you a hotel room. It's this December. It's called the Lexus Champions for Charity. So we're selling raffle tickets. It's $100 for one ticket, and it's for two spots. The drawing is going to be on October 31st. I'll do it at South County Lexus in Mission Viejo. But think about it, $100 for a chance at this dream trip. And we can sell 1,000 tickets. We've sold less than 100, so your chances of winning right now are really good.
Can I just tell you, it's like a grand to play Pebble Beach, and that's if you're staying in the Villas.
Yeah.
So to have Spyglass and Spanish Bay, which they all neighbor each other.
Yeah.
That's like a $5,000 pound.
Like the value of this with all the swag.
It's the memories. It's more. It's not even just the money. Like
people can play Pebble Beach. They can afford that.
Yes. Like this is a. This is a dream kind of thing. Especially, and you said it's $100 for...
For one ticket. For two people.
And there are under 100 people who have...
Yeah, so look, I have 1,000.
Do you have to be there to buy the ticket?
Okay, so here's how you do. Go to my website.
No.
It's easy. But so because I'm a 501c3, I have to get a raffle license. Like, there's a whole legality
to
this.
I'm sure, yeah.
So you have to buy one of those things, right? You spend, and you also need this.
And then you have to have Vanna White come out and actually pick it.
Yeah, her and Ryan Seacrest. So what happens is you go to my website, you call the phone number, Leilani will answer the phone. It's super easy, takes less than 5 minutes, and then I actually mail you the raffle ticket. In the mail, or you can go to the dealership, South County Lexus in Mission Viejo, and buy one in person. Okay. But you can buy them at the tournament day of. You know, it's like considered gambling, so it's very fine line about how we can do this legally. So you know, there's a process to it. But we said it's a 1,000 chance. Right now, your chances are so much better.
Yeah.
So buy the tickets. We'll do the drawing at the end of the month. And what an amazing way for me to raise more money.
Yes.
So it's going to be a lot of fun, and I'm super excited that you're going to come after the morning show.
Do you let me drive this year?
You can drive a golf cart.
Just go around. Hi, boys.
Yeah. Hey,
ladies.
Want a cigar? Literally last year.
But it is fun. Like, look, a lot of people who want to support and say, I don't golf, like, the dinner part is so fun. It's just a lot of energy, and you can really make a difference just by showing up. You can go to the website. Reach out to me through email if you want to help but you can't come, or you want to find something creative to do, because it makes a huge difference. Mm-hmm. I cannot tell you how much it just, like, kills my heart to see these videos of dogs who are, like, on their last day at a shelter because they're going to be euthanized because we don't have enough space in the county and city shelters. So anything that we can do to cut down on the pet population, like, you know that I spend so much time working on this.
No, I was just going to bring that up. Being that we did the weekend show together, she spends, between every hit, you are working on this big
this
event.
Tournament,
so come out, let's turn up for Case. High
how,
five
how
to
many,
you.
How many animals do you have at home?
I only have 2. Oh,
okay.
That was a loaded question. How many of them are dogs and how many of them are cats?
Stop it. Again, the 4th annual Fix It.
You have more than 10 cats.
I just wanted to get that out there because people may, you know, wonder.
Inquiring minds.
Rich.
Thank you.
Exactly. Dark Rich.
It's the 4th annual Fix and Fidos golf tournament. It's taking place again October 6th. That's right around the corner. Mm-hmm. You can get more information. Register by visiting fixinfidos.com. Thanks again for coming.
Thank you guys so
much. Good luck.
We'll
be
there.
And
I'll see you there.
Ooh, time now for today's corporate marketing stunt of the day. In honor of spooky season, the folks at Ring Camera want to see your haunted houses. Anyone who has caught paranormal activity on their home security system could get a huge payday. Ring is holding a competition that will award $100,000 to the person with the most compelling paranormal activity caught on their Ring device. The Great Ghost Search, open to all Americans 18 and up. And you have until November the 1st to enter. For more information, just go to ring.com/ghost search. How many people are going to be creating their own little videos using technology to create stuff?
AI this year.
Maybe put something on a small fishing line and have it float across.
That's actually kind of fun
the
to do for the kids.
The witch's hat hanging from
it would be a good project. Yeah. Hey, let's do something for this. Let's see if we can fool people.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. This is really smart for Ring. They take it like
we're doing it.
This exactly.
As Kristen
smart.
Pointed
no,
out,
Ring is, they're
corporate marketing stunt of the day.
Yeah.
Easy.
All right. Something as simple as changing your email signature might help you find a work-life balance. It started gaining in popularity during the pandemic when people were working from home and lines around work and play were blurred. HuffPost talked to a small business owner who put a note under her name and social media handles on her signature, which says, I respect boundaries around personal time, caretaking, and rest. If this email arrives while you're doing any of those things, please protect your time and wait to respond until you are back at work or your computer. A freelance writer recently went viral for her disclaimer, which says, please note, I may be slower to respond to email in the months of June, July, and August due to the United States' inability to provide affordable childcare for working mothers. Others are simply adding their office hours.
This that is person, their kid must, obviously the months their kids are out of school.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, gotcha.
And I get it. She's making a statement there, yeah. which, you know, I get that. And I think this is a problem, but it's also something that the way I see it is that, you know, because I do my emails at all hours of the day because we're up at early hours. I work on the weekends, whatever. But like my feeling is like you reply when you can.
Totally. Yeah.
I mean, it's an email.
I kind of like, feel that way about text messages. Yeah, I'm too. Cognizant of like it's 4 a.m, Meg. Yeah. I was going to do it this morning.
Two different categories.
Mom.
Yeah, texts are a little.
Sometimes I'm like, people text, know what I do.
Text unless there's something obvious about it not.
There are certain people I'll text at whatever hour.
If I'm tied up and I don't even see the text, that's different. But if I see it, I tend to respond pretty much right away because I will forget to. There's been times where I'm like, oh, I'll get to that later, and then I space it and I'm apologizing.
Sometimes it's 2 days, and I don't even apologize. Hey, so good to hear from you. And keep it moving.
Email is much more chill, in my opinion.
Email is like when you get to it, when you open it. But text, I agree. People, when they send you a text, it feels like it should be an immediate response.
Yes.
And that's kind of like, that's our kind of social contract with texting.
I need to know something about the email.
Yeah. Got your email.
Hey, listen, I shot check you an email. Inbox. Check it when you can.
Yes.
Just to give you a heads up because I know it gets
good.
Buried.
Also,
because I know it does for me.
For me, the email is... It's one of those things where the expectations are just different. A text, I will get back to it. And I will tell people, if you want my more immediate response, text me. If you're okay with me getting to it whenever. And you may even have to remind me that you sent me an email, like you just did.
Yeah.
Like you talked about doing.
To me, I don't love an email because I just will.
We get a lot of them.
We get a lot of emails. It gets lost in the shuffle.
Thousands of emails.
Yeah. Because we're on lists. People put us on lists, and I'm just like, how do
you're
I get
on
this?
A few lists that you really have been trying to get off
of. Do Not Fly was one thing, but I'll tell you, it wasn't my fault. That lady kept kicking my chair.
Yeah.
That's a joke.
Joke.
Nominees.
But schedule text. iOS 18, you can now schedule text.
I love that.
I did it this morning because it was at 7 a.m.
Is
I'm like,
it easy,
I need...
though, or a lot of steps?
No, it's very easy.
You haven't done it yet?
It's
going to change your life. You haven't scheduled a text yet?
It
changes your life. You can do it.
Go into your text. Look right here. So when you're in your text, you just press this little plus sign, and you'll see it says send later. So press the plus.
But it only works with someone else who has an Apple phone.
Yeah, only iOS 18 right now.
Mine doesn't have it.
Yes, it does.
You might have to drag it up from the bottom. It's sometimes in the list because they buried it at the bottom of the list.
Did first of all, have you haven't?
I probably haven't updated.
You haven't updated.
You have to update.
By the way, once you do update to iOS 18, you're gonna love it. I like it. It's got a lot of. It's more playful, if you will. It's got a lot of cool.
To me from the future.
You're right.
I mean,
when you get up to old man Schauble's level.
I mean, look, if you want to tint your icons, see your icons. You
is
can
that
now.
An apple?
You can.
Yes, I'm telling you.
Right, let's see. So now
like
you can tint them.
It reminds me of the old days with my Android.
Yes.
When I used to be able to do everything.
Like, exactly.
By the way, I don't do all that.
Everything old is new again.
Yeah. But the whole schedule a text to another iPhone user is really good, especially the hours that, you know, with you on weekends.
But why my auto updates are on?
You gotta go to iOS 18 right there.
Oh.
But is this gonna put me out of commission for?
Only for a few minutes because our
Wi-Fi. Unless something goes wrong.
Our Wi-Fi here at the station is super fast.
Okay, it is fast.
By the way, I would do it here.
If you like this Discord, check out my radio show on weekends. Rich on Tech on KFI AM 640, 11 a.m. This is what I do for 3 hours.
Okay, by the way, this is you doing pet of the day.
Oh, it's time for our pet of the day. This is Riley. He is a 6-year-old Staffordshire Bull Terrier mix. Riley's life started out pretty rough, But he was adopted at 4 months old, lived happily with a family, but he was given up due to a tragedy in that family. Now he's looking for another home. Oh, he's a little shy, but he loves to play, especially with other dogs. Riley grew up around kids and dogs of all sizes, and he would love it if his new home had at least one other dog to play with. He doesn't want to be alone. Okay. If you're interested, contact Paws for San Bernardino Paws by visiting pawsforsbpaws.org. That's a good looking boy. Mm-hmm. We'll be right back.
Show and tell. We love show and tell. And our AKA is Alpha Kappa Alpha. In support of International Coastal Cleanup Day in partnership with the environmental nonprofit Heal the Bay, nearly 200 members of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated came together this past Sunday for their second annual Greenwell event. It's at Santa Monica's historic Inkwell in Crescent Bay Park. They cleaned up the local parks and waterways the day prior. 18 AKA chapters and many community volunteers took part in all of this all across Southern California, making our communities greener. So bravo to the AKAs. Also, today is National Daughters Day. Showing off my babes.
Wow.
My two younger twin daughters are on the left. The older twin daughters are on the right. So in order from left to right, Kelsey, Kendall, Shelby, and Sydney.
Beautiful picture.
Thank you.
Like, good head on their shoulders.
They take after their mama.
Okay, was
this,
well said.
Was this in Mexico?
That was in Mexico. Yeah. That was in Cancun when we celebrated our 30th anniversary.
Good. All right, Megan, what do you got?
Oh, this is my Instagram. We were at the Big House. I alluded to this earlier, right? So Caesar and Ima has been right there. Oh, there you go.
Sorry.
Here we go. If you've never been to the Big House in Ann Arbor, just outside of Detroit, there's Hubby there. This is a good look at the stadium. It is the largest, I mean, quote me, don't quote me, but the largest in the Western Hemisphere, the stadium, in terms of the number of people packed in. I'll tell you, it's bench seating, so I was underneath the armpit pretty much of the person next to me. They have a really cool tradition, and singing the Killers and the
They also
the
wear
quarter.
All those shirts, so you, like, they spelled out in the audience with yellow.
It's very coordinated, the pomp and circumstance. Go,
but
cool
we lost.
Michigan. Go
you
USA.
And your husband make an incredibly looking, good-looking couple.
Oh, thank you.
You guys look great.
And happy National Daughter's Day to my daughter, Lola Gray. Mwah. See you guys next time.
Fun times.
Thank you. Fun times.